Hey everyone, welcome back to M-Coding with James Murphy. That's me. Today, I'm getting you up to speed with your ABCs. Wait, can I say that, or is this going to get flagged as for kids? No, not the alphabet ABCs. Of course, I'm talking about abstract base classes. Specifically, the abstract collections defined in the collections ABC module. I'll talk about when and why you should use them, including both their typing and runtime, and their mix-in use cases. Then we'll finish up with this example where we use an abstract collection to implement this invertible dictionary class. It's just like a dictionary that you can use to map keys to values, but you can also map those values back to their starting keys. Let's get started by taking a quick look at the collections ABC docs. The first thing to notice is that there are quite a few of these ABCs. Their primary purpose is to serve as sort of an interface to some of the built-in tools. So if you wanted to write your own version of that tool, you would just know that you need to implement these methods to conform to that interface. Some are very simple interfaces, like the iterable, which just needs to define a dunder-iter method. And others, like the sequence or mutable sequence, require a few more methods. So if I want my type to be considered a sequence, I should define a getItem length contains iter reversed index and count function. If you want to be considered a sequence, you do need all of these methods. But these are also ABCs. You can use them as base classes. And if you use them as a base class, then really you only need to define the things in this middle column. So if I define getItem and length and inherit from sequence, then Python will provide default implementations of the things in this right column. Also notice that there's a sequence and a mutable sequence. There's a set and a mutable set. There's a mapping and a mutable mapping. Remember, these are just interfaces, so if you annotate something as being a mapping, that doesn't mean it also can't be mutable. This distinction has more to do with type hinting as a way of telling your callers that you're not going to modify their map rather than defining a type that can't be mutated, although that's also a possibility. Obviously, there's too many of these to fully cover in one video, so that's why I'm announcing a 15-part sequence of... No, I'm just kidding. There's just a few that are the most common that you'll actually use. Iterable, stuff you can iterate over. Sequence and mutable sequence are the abstract versions of a list. Then there's set and mutable set, which is the abstract version of a set, and mapping and mutable mapping, which are the abstract versions of a dictionary. I recommend just coming back to this table if you ever need to remember what's part of the interface. For the rest of this video, I'm just going to focus on mapping and mutable mapping. So on to our first example use case, type hinting. Here's a very simple function that's meant to take in a dictionary and just delete the entry with the smallest key. If it's empty, we just return, we don't error, we find the smallest key, and then delete that entry. Now, I'm not saying that you should be type hinting all of your code all the time. I think type hinting is an optional feature of Python, as it should be. One of the main benefits, of course, is autocomplete. Because I haven't type hinted D, PyCharm is giving me basically no good suggestions here. But if I annotate it as a dict and try again, now I'm getting a lot more relevant suggestions. And yes, you can get even better suggestions if you specify the key type and value type. But one issue that a lot of people don't think about is how restrictive this becomes for the caller of the function. As the author of code like this, it might be most convenient to specify an exact type here. But if this isn't an internal function and there may be other people calling your function, putting this type hint here actually becomes a restriction. Doing an if check, finding the minimum key, and deleting a key are not specific to the built-in dict type. If a user has something like a dictionary type, maybe they're wrapping a dictionary type, they might still want to use your function, and your implementation might still work for them. But because of your restrictive type hint, now their editor is going to complain that they're doing something wrong when, in fact, maybe it's just fine. In many cases, if you've hinted something to be a dictionary and it's a public-facing API, consider that a mutable mapping might be a more flexible option. Also note that our use of mutable mapping helps inform our caller that we do intend to mutate their dictionary, which may not have been apparent if we had just annotated it as a dict. But type hinting isn't the only use case for these abstract collections. It's possible to check, and a lot of code does check, whether something is an instance or a subclass of one of these ABCs at runtime. This allows you to react differently based off of the structure of the object that you received, something that is actually quite useful in a dynamic language like Python. Here we're defining a deepmin, which is just like a min, but it will also traverse any structures like lists or dictionaries and go inside of them to find the smallest element. So even if I had this nested list of numbers, deepmin would still find this zero and pick that out as the minimum. If something is iterable, then we just like to recursively find the deepmin and then take the min of those. But specifically for mappings, we may not be interested in the keys, like we don't want to find the minimum key. So if we do see a mapping, then we only recurse into the values, not the keys. And if we get something not iterable, like a number, then that's our base case and we just return the value. It's pretty common for a library author to do this kind of switching, and if they do, it would typically be based off of one of the ABCs in the collections.abc module. There's also a lot of Python internals that uses this machinery. For instance, if you're using the match statement from Python 3.10, then a case like this that looks like it's using a dictionary will actually match against any mapping type. If you want your custom type to pass these as instance or also as subclass checks, then you can of course inherit from mapping. Or if you don't want to or can't inherit from mapping, you could also fake inherit from it by using the register method. This will make Python treat this class like it's a subclass of mapping, even if it's not. Now, you're basically asking Python to just trust you on this one, so if you do this, then make sure that you actually implement the interface, otherwise weird things might fail. All right, so how do we actually make our own mapping type? We're going to see by implementing an invertible dictionary, which is like a two-way dictionary. It can go from keys to values, but it can also take values and go back to keys. Now, of course, type ints are completely optional, but I think it actually clears things up in this case, so I will go ahead and put them in. KT and VT stand for key type and value type. We're going to implement this invertible dict by just having two dictionaries, a forward dictionary and a backward dictionary. Forward maps keys to values, and backward maps values to keys. We'll go ahead and use slots, because why not? See my video on slots. For this example, we want to actually inherit from mutable mapping, because we want to take advantage of the mixin default implementation methods. Going back to this wonderful table, we see that if we define getItem, setItem, delItem, iter, and length, then Python will define all the rest of these methods for us, meaning we don't have to define any of these standard dictionary functions or any of these mutating dictionary functions. The abstract base class will provide default implementations just using the five that we actually did provide. So we go back to our implementation, and these are the five that we actually need to define. After we define those five, then we could use our class just like we use a dictionary in most cases. Everything else is either extra functionality, like the inverse function, or a typical customization point like a wrapper, or a custom implementation of something that could have been provided by the ABC. We'll see more on that later. Of course, the way we write these five depends a lot on the structure of our class. The way I've designed things, our class just stores the forward and backward dictionaries, which we initialize in the init function. Typically, we would just have the user pass in the forward dictionary, and then we would just compute the backwards one. Depending on what they provide, we either start with an empty forward and backward, or we start with the forward they give us and compute the backward. Or if they provide this backward param, it's kind of like a secret parameter, then we just use it. It's kind of a convention in Python that if you have a keyword-only argument that starts with an underscore, it's kind of like a private implementation detail. Of course, it doesn't actually stop anyone from using it, but that's the way that we're going to be using it. So our own internal functions, like the inverse function, might want to provide this backward argument, but a typical user shouldn't be providing it. The specific details of init are actually not that important. Just keep in mind that forward and backwards are just plain old dictionaries. So, when someone goes to look up a key, how do they do it? Well, looking up a key is pretty simple. We just look it up using the forward dictionary. Similarly, the length of our dictionary is just the length of the forward dictionary, and the way that we iterate over the keys of our dictionary is just iterating over the keys of the forward dictionary. The mutating functions like setItem and delItem do have to involve the backwards dictionary, though. We'll go through it slowly, but just keep in mind that the mathematical invariant of this class is that the forward and backward dictionaries represent inverse mappings of each other. They should define a mathematical one-to-one correspondence. A key maps to a value from the forwards direction if and only if the value maps back to the key in the backwards direction. So let's take a look at the setItem. Taking a look at the end here, what we ultimately do is maintain that class invariant that the forward and backward are inverse maps of each other. In the forward map, we map key to value, and in the backward map, we map value to key. Simple as that. All the rest of this is to handle the cases where either the key or the value already existed in the dictionary. This checks whether the value that we're trying to set already has a key associated with it. If it does, and it's a different key, then we're trying to break the class invariant. We're trying to create two different keys that map to the same value. That's an error. This would happen if I started with a dictionary like 1A and then tried to set 2A. That's perfectly fine in a normal dictionary, but this is supposed to be an invertible dictionary. So if I had one mapping to A and two mapping to A, then what would the inverse of A be? That would be an error, so we just raise an exception. This next case is for if the key that we're trying to set already existed in the dictionary. So for instance, say that we had one mapping to A, so in the backwards dictionary, we have A mapping to one. We could set one mapping to B and B mapping to one, that's fine. But that backwards dictionary would still have the A mapping to 1 in it, so we need to delete it first. It's okay whether or not the values were equal, we're just going to reset it right here anyway. Then we get to delItem, which is thankfully much simpler. We're given the key, we look up the value, and then delete it from both directions. Not too much going on there, and that's all five. Because we define these five, we can now use our InvertibleDict just like we would any other mutable mapping. Now the most fun slash elegant part, in my opinion, how do we access inverse elements? You might be tempted to do something like make an inverse getItem function that takes values and gives you back keys, and you could do that, but you would end up rewriting a lot of code. You need the inverse getItem, setItem, delItem, iter, length, get. But wait, those are all functions that are provided by mapping. I'm just describing another mapping. So what we do instead is provide one extra function to access the inverse. We make a .inv property that just swaps the forward and backward maps. Forward and backward are already inverses of each other, so I don't need to do any extra work. I just create a new invertible dict whose forward map is my backward map and whose backward map is my forward map. Then check it out, we can use it just like this. We create an invertible dict. We can print it or print its inverse. We can check that one maps to A, and we can check that the inverse of A maps to 1. Then we can assign the inverse of D as 4, and then check that 4 maps to D. This works because the function and its inverse are sharing the same underlying dictionaries. Modifying the function is modifying the inverse, and modifying the inverse is modifying the function. Because I defined a wrapper, we can print these things out. The wrapper only shows you the forward dictionary. So if we print the function, we see 1a, 2b, 3c. And if we print the inverse, we see a1, b2, c3. And then the second lines, we can see that setting the inverse d equals 4 actually sets both of them. This can be extremely useful when you're translating between two different representations of a fixed number of objects. A way to tell if you might benefit from using this kind of invertible dictionary is to ask yourself, do I have just two dictionaries that have the same data mapping in opposite directions? Like if you had two dictionaries, int to char and char to int. That's the kind of situation where you might have data on either side and want to convert between them. So feel free to use this idea. All right, I do have one more practical piece of advice on the matter. We saw an implementation that was inheriting from mutable mapping, and mutable mapping was providing a bunch of functionality. It defines pop, it defines pop item, clear, update, all these things, and it defines them correctly. But that doesn't mean that these default implementations are the most efficient. For instance, look at how it's doing clear. It's basically got a while true and tries to pop item. It's popping items off one at a time until it gets a key error. Now, for a general mutable mapping, that is sort of the most general thing that you can do that would be correct, pop things off one at a time. But our implementation is using two dictionaries, which both themselves have clear methods. We don't need to pop things off one at a time. So for efficiency's sake, you may find yourself re-implementing a lot of those functions that you were supposed to get for free as mix-ins. From my own experience, I've definitely found that to be the case, especially for the more complex interfaces like mutable mapping. And after a few months or maybe a year, I've re-implemented everything that was a mix-in, at which point I may even no longer inherit from mutable mapping and instead just use a typing generic or not inherit from anything at all. Just remember that if you do this, you will probably want to make your class register with mutable mapping so that it will still be treated as a mutable mapping, a mapping type. And finally, for the more advanced typing users, unfortunately, I'm not going to talk about one of the bigger benefits of using these interfaces. It has to do with covariance and contravariance of type variables, which unfortunately I just have not set up the prerequisites to talk about. But if you're extra studious, go ahead and look those up in the typing library. I'm sure there's plenty for you to learn. Thanks to my patrons and donors for supporting me. If you really like my channel, please consider becoming a patron or donor. Don't forget to comment, subscribe, slap that like button an odd number of times, and I'll see you in the next one. Also, I have a secret giveaway for anyone that stayed to the end.